These are the data of the International Society Registry, which includes nearly 80% of the world transplant activity. These data indicate that heart transplantation in pediatric age reached a stable trend with regards to overall number of procedures and age distribution. You can see that in the last 10 years, we do in the world about 500 pediatric transplants per year. During the last 15 years, indications to transplant have significantly changed. Indications for congenital heart disease are slowly increasing, whereas those for cardiomyopathy are decreasing. More in detail, indications for congenital heart disease decreased during the first year of life, as you can see here, whereas it has increased in adolescent age. Similarly, at the Bambino Gesù Children's Hospital in Rome, congenital transplant recipients represent approximately 40% of the transplant population, with 56% of cardiomyopathy and 5% of retransplant. The results obtained with transplanted patients show that today the main limits of pediatric heart transplantation are represented by the organ availability and the unpredictable donor-recipient matching. Here we can see the tendency to often use donors bigger than recipients. The use of oversized heart has been associated with increased technical and surgical problems. An analysis of the International Society database suggests that a donor-recipient weight ratio more than 2.5 is associated with a significantly increased risk of one-year mortality in pediatric heart transplant recipients, particularly related to neurologic complications. With regards to bridge to transplantation, there is growing interest in the development of the technique of mechanical bridge in pediatric age. Actually, 35% of the patients, of pediatric patients, are bridged with mechanical circulatory support. The management of our waiting list has changed during years. In 2006, of 249 patients who were listed, 127 received a heart transplant, whereas 79, that is almost 32%, deceased while waiting. But if we divided this data, analyzing separately the first 15 years and the last 5, we can see that mortality during the wait reduced from 37% to 21%. We have shown first how the waiting list has been changed over the year. In this slide, the waiting list for transplant at Bambino Gesù Hospital in Rome in May 1989. There were 5 patients with cardiomyopathy and 5 with congenital heart disease, but very small for age and weight. 4 of them died while waiting. As a consequence, 10 years later, the congenital patients were much less on the list. More recently, in 2009, we discovered a completely different scenario, with a lot of congenital patients, but bigger for age and weight as a result of previous surgical treatments. A significant percentage of these patients present pulmonary hypertension with left ventricular failure. As for the adults, demographics for pediatric heart failures is changing, particularly for the group of congenital patients, which is quickly growing up. Today, we are faced with an increasing borderline population who requires a better definition of indication criteria in order to optimize timing and use of heart transplantation. In the care of these patients, we can profitably take into account criteria which originate from transplantation experience, in particular when surgical management of congenital heart disease is concerned. It is worth noting that both infants and children show a significantly lower risk of late mortality than adolescents. Immunological factors and reduced compliance to therapies in adolescent age may play a key role in determining these results. The patients who were palliated with tomographs may become sensitized to a wide variety of leukocyte antigens. They represent an increasing hair transplant population who requires specific consideration and postoperative immuno options. The number of transplanted patients with positive panel reactive antibody is growing up, as reported also by the International Registry. Practice guidelines for management of heart failure in children, published by Richard Kirk and other colleagues in 2014, represent the most important recent attempt to reorganize this matter. Today, we focus on pulmonary hypertension due to left heart disease as the perhaps most common pulmonary hypertension scenario. Pulmonary hypertension due to left heart disease has been defined as a postcapillary form of pulmonary hypertension. A significant proportion of patients with severe systolic left ventricle dysfunction and pulmonary hypertension have right ventricular dysfunction, which has been shown to be predictive of survival and clinical events in patients with pulmonary hypertension and chronic heart failure. It is now well established that pulmonary hypertension in patients with left heart failure is associated with increased mortality and morbidity, worse exercise tolerance, and adverse outcomes after heart transplantation. Fixed pulmonary hypertension could be found in less than 10% of patients with pulmonary hypertension due to systolic heart failure. In these non-responsive cases, irreversible obstructive remodeling was suspected. The International Society for Heart and Lung Transplantation has defined unresponsive fixed pulmonary hypertension in patients with systolic heart failure awaiting heart transplantation as when the systolic pulmonary artery pressure remains more than 50 millimeters of mercury, the pulmonary vascular resistance more than 5 Wood units, and the transpulmonary gradient more than 16 millimeters of mercury after pharmacological testing. The pulmonary hypertension attributable to structural remodeling is generally referred as fixed because it is not rapidly responsive to reversal with pharmacological treatments. But now several different groups have shown that mechanical left ventricle unloading is able to reverse previously suspected fixed precapillary transpulmonary gradient or pulmonary vascular resistance, allowing candidacy for heart transplantation. This structural change could explain why pulmonary hypertension, even in range of values not excluding heart transplantation, is a risk factor for postoperative right ventricular failure after heart transplantation and influences post-heart transplant pulmonary hemodynamic behavior. In 2009, the European Society of Cardiology guidelines for the diagnosis and treatment of pulmonary hypertension differentiates between passive and reactive pulmonary hypertension due to left heart disease according to very specific transpulmonary gradient cutoff values. The authors selected a transpulmonary gradient limit of more than 12 millimeters of mercury as reactive and less than 12 as passive pulmonary hypertension. But such nomenclature completely ignores the very complex function of the pulmonary vascular bed to regulate the interplay between the often very differently affected right and left ventricular function. A dynamically changing transpulmonary gradient pulmonary vascular resistance could regulate the afterload sensitive ejection of the right ventricle in order to adjust the ventricular preload of a diseased left heart and to protect it from a volume overload. Before considering a therapeutic intervention of pulmonary hypertension due to left ventricle systolic or diastolic dysfunction, a reliable hemodynamic test or imaging method is needed to differentiate the out-of-proportion pulmonary hypertension from the reactive protective form. This seems necessary because the same pulmonary selective vasodilative therapy would lead to very useful hemodynamic and clinical results in the frank out-of-proportion situation, but possibly to left ventricular volume overload and consecutive pulmonary congestion in the reactive protective form. The European Society of Cardiology, European Respiratory Society guidelines clearly discourage the use of drugs approved for pulmonary arterial hypertension in patients with pulmonary hypertension due to left heart disease due to the lack of evidence for a favorable risk-to-benefit ratio. Emerging data suggest a role for mechanical circulatory support alone or in combination with medical therapy. Transpulmonary gradient, pulmonary vascular resistance, but not mean pulmonary arterial pressure, are predictive parameters for successful heart transplantation in cases of severe postcapillary pulmonary hypertension. When no significant decrease in pulmonary vascular resistance and transpulmonary gradient after 3-4 days of pharmacological therapy is observed, mechanical circulatory support is the only option to bridge end-stage heart failure patients to heart transplantation. The rate at which pulmonary vascular disease develops in pediatric restrictive cardiomyopathy, faster than in dilated cardiomyopathy, requiring transplantation at a younger age. It may be argued that to reduce the risk, transplantation should be performed early in the disease, but referring a relatively well child for transplantation needs careful consideration. An early transplantation strategy seems prudent. Increase of pulmonary pressure is of concern in this disease. It has been shown that it may be modulated with prolonged intravenous prostacycline use. When this is considered with the advances in mechanical support and pediatric intensive care, orthotopic transplantation may offer a better alternative to heart lung transplantation for some recipients with moderate pulmonary hypertension. In 2007, a little girl, 5 years old, presented at our department with restrictive cardiomyopathy and pulmonary hypertension. Transpulmonary gradient was 19 millimeters of mercury. Prostacycline infusion was impossible in the context of low cardiac output and systemic hypotension. A biventricular assist device, Berlin Heart, was implanted, giving the chance to use IV prostacyclines. 1 month later, transpulmonary gradient dropped to 8 millimeters of mercury, and the patient received the heart transplant after 2 months. Actually, she is alive and well. A major issue in pediatric heart transplantation concerns the evaluation of pulmonary and systemic circulation in patients who were listed for failing Fontan operation. Patients with single ventricle physiology are predicted to represent 70 to 80% of patients transplanted for congenital heart disease in the near future. This was the waiting list at September 2011 at Bambino Gesù Hospital in Rome, with 17 congenital patients, 16 of whom with univentricular heart, and only 5 with cardiomyopathies. Nevertheless, congenital heart disease still represents the leading independent predictor of 1-year mortality after pediatric heart transplantation, doubling the risk of death of orthotopic transplantation for non-congenital diagnosis. This occurs while 63% of orthotopic transplantation in infancy are accomplished on patients with congenital heart disease. Therefore, the issue is twofold. Data from international registry still show as one of the major risk factors for early mortality the diagnosis of congenital heart disease. Then there are the clinical conditions at the moment of transplant, such as the need of intensive care and circulatory support. In Fontan physiology, blood flow through the pulmonary arteries is non-pulsatile and largely driven by negative intrathoracic pressure and diastolic relaxation of the single ventricle. In the absence of pulsatile flow, recruitment of pulmonary vessels is reduced, potentially resulting in increased pulmonary vascular resistances. Low cardiac output, excessive hypoxemia, protein losing enteropathy, and plastic bronchitis may all be clinical manifestations of increased pulmonary vascular resistance after Fontan completion. The development of pathologies such as protein dispersion syndromes, aortopulmonary collaterals, or pulmonary AV malformations cannot be frequently explained by hemodynamic pitfalls and represent the most critical complications of the Fontan patients. The pathophysiologic mechanism resulting in protein losing enteropathy is still enigmatic, but two issues are believed to be involved: lower mesenteric oxygen delivery and inflammation. Gastrointestinal perfusion and oxygen delivery are reduced after Fontan completion. Orthotopic heart transplantation for structural congenital heart disease with single ventricle physiology entails substantial early mortality. Nevertheless, bidirectional GLEN enables the best transition to heart transplant. Beyond cavo pulmonary shunt staging, orthotopic heart transplantation should be considered in the decision-making process as an alternative to confirmed completion in high-risk candidates, since rescue orthotopic transplantation after failing Fontan seems unwarranted. Lamour and colleagues conducted a study on behalf of the Cardiac Transplant Registry database in association with the Pediatric Heart Transplant Study Group on 480 patients with congenital heart disease, 107 Fontan and 381 non-Fontan, undergoing orthotopic transplantation between 1993 and 2002. Lamour demonstrated that Fontan patients had a 71% 1 year and 60% 5 year transplant survival, significantly lower than 83 and 74 survival documented in non-Fontan patients with congenital heart disease. Specifically, having a previous Fontan procedure increased 8.6 times the relative risk of death after transplantation in this cohort. Conditional survival in patients who survived the first 3 months after transplant was not different between Fontan and non-Fontan congenital heart disease patients, indicating that the increased risk of death is likely related to peritransplant issues. These reports suggest that the presentation for the failed Fontan circulation is twofold: failed Fontan physiology and ventricular dysfunction, failed Fontan physiology such as refractory ascites, pleural effusion, protein loss enteropathy, plastic bronchitis may occur in the setting of a relatively preserved ventricular function. Characterization of ventricular function in patients with undetermined or right dominant ventricular morphology is largely subjective, and measurement of the end-diastolic pressure in underload ventricles with low output and poor transit of systemic venous blood to the lungs may be misleading. Based on these findings, Griffith and Del Nido identified the indication to orthotopic transplantation performed at Boston Children's Hospital between 1994 and 2008 in failed Fontan with impaired ventricular function versus patients with preserved ventricular function but failed Fontan physiology. 1 year actuarial survival after orthotopic transplantation was almost 89 in impaired ventricular function versus 56% in preserved ventricular function. Excellent orthotopic transplantation outcome and 90% 1 year survival is predicted for late Fontan failures with predominant ventricular dysfunction and without significant comorbidities such as hepatic cirrhosis or chronic malnutrition. Orthotopic transplantation should be considered as an alternative to Fontan completion in the decision-making algorithm for high-risk Fontan candidates, since rescue transplantation after early Fontan failure is unwarranted. A few words now related to the management of transplant recipients. This is a recent presentation at the 2013 meeting of the International Society with a provocative title, Pediatric Transplantation, Art, Science, or Voodoo, Routine Biopsies and Coronary Angiography are Overrated in Children. Pediatric heart transplantation, is it art? Looking at this magnificent painting of Alonso de Sedano, we really wonder about it. Is it science? Several immunologic pathways proposed by transplant immunologists could also prompt us to give a positive answer. Is it voodoo? Probably not. But when faced by this kind of familiar picture, doubts may arise. Endomyocardial biopsy is presently considered gold standard test in the diagnosis of acute cellular rejection, as reported by Daphne Su in her 2005 editorial in Pediatric Transplantation. This is the number of biopsies performed at Bambino Gesù in 55 patients transplanted between 86 and 94. 2,033 biopsies were performed. This is the first group. 233 biopsies in 55 patients in this era. The second group, 76 patients, but only 110 biopsies. The last group, just 8 biopsies in 98 patients from 2004 and 2012. Histologic studies in patients transplanted between, in the first group, patients transplanted between 86 and 94, rejection type 3E tends to disappear with time. But we also notice that in the larger patient group 2, incidence of type 3A rejection is greatly reduced early postoperatively, while in the group 3, it is almost absent. Here we show our late mortality, later than the first post-transplant year, in the three groups. A dramatic drop is noticeable. You can see that the late mortality from 16 patients, you know, of 55 years just to on 98. Already in 2008, based on this observation, in Moss and Adams, it's reported that, furthermore, if the gold standard for diagnosis allograft rejection after heart transplantation is still considered the endomyocardial biopsy, the value of routine surveillance biopsies is also controversial in children. In fact, many centers have discontinued routine surveillance biopsies after the first or second year from transplantation. And this is in the guidelines by the International Society of 2012. Given the increased risk of complications, many centers minimize the number of endomyocardial biopsies in very small children and avoid them altogether in infants. While at a few pediatric centers, no routine endomyocardial biopsies are performed in pre-adolescents due to the opinion that echo is sufficient for rejection surveillance in asymptomatic patients. With these data and clinical experiences in mind, an answer can be offered to the titled question, pediatric transplantation is not art. Moreover, we do not believe that it is science. Probably Albert Einstein, father of relativity, would react so to such a statement. In conclusion, non-invasive evaluation of heart transplant patients, is it not art, not voodoo, not do we claim it is science. We refer to it as applied medicine, perhaps the best form of care by properly trained people for a young person going through life with a new heart. This is our global experience at Bambino Gesù Hospital in Rome with thoracic transplants. We do 280 thoracic transplants, 261 of which involve the heart. And those are the survival curves by surgical era. In the last decade, we have 88% survival at 8 years. It's this score. These data compare satisfactorily with those of the registry. These are registry survival curves showing 8 year survival around 70%. Therefore, our monitorization without a surveillance biopsies does not seem to negatively affect late outcome. Here, the registry survival curves by ERA, again, the Bambino Gesù curves compare satisfactorily with the international registry. Apart from immunosuppressive treatment, researchers today devote their greatest efforts to find a method to induce tolerance. The need of alternative treatments without serious side effects is particularly felt in children who, as far as we know, will continue immunosuppressive therapies forever. The efficacy of photophoresis in reducing acute and chronic rejection after cardiac transplantation has been previously described by Mark Barr and others. Anyway, why is the use of this procedure still limited despite its efficacy? The mechanism of action is not known in detail, which may have caused some doubt on its reliability. This work, published by our group, tries answering to some of these questions. With this background, we are verifying the possible effectiveness of photophoresis in patients with coronary artery vasculopathy, which is a 3-4 Stanford grade intimal thickening of coronary vessel walls measured by means of intravascular ultrasound. All patients suffering from vasculopathy, coronary vasculopathy, receive an immunosuppressive protocol with calcineurin inhibitors like cyclosporine or tacrolimus associated with antiproliferative agents like everolimus or sirolimus and statins. 29 patients with a mean age of 11 years were treated with photophoresis. There was in this patient a statistically significant decrease in the levels of the pro-inflammatory cytokines with a significant clinical impact. Actually, we use the photophoresis with these indications: chronic rejection, renal failure, post-transplant lymphoproliferative disorder, and tumors when we need to reduce drug dosages. Well, we can conclude that today, heart transplant is not the last resource. It can be considered as a competitive treatment for heart failure in both congenital and acquired pediatric cardiac disease. Major limitations for pediatric heart transplantation remain organ availability and unpredictable donor-recipient matching. In this view, I like to conclude my presentation with this video.
Che cosa ti piacerebbe fare?
Tutti gli amori del mondo.
Seemed to want to comfort us. We then had a
choice either to bury his organs or to give them to someone else. So it seemed a very simple choice to us. We donated his organs, and as a result, five people who had died lived, and two people who are going blind can now see. So we have never for a moment regretted having made this decision. He has saved the lives, not just of those seven people, but thousands of people around the world have heard this story, and they have said to themselves, I should do that as well.
La seconda era molto più piccola della sua età. Un secondo era fortemente immunodepresso perché perdeva anche le difese dell'organismo, perdeva anche l'immunoglobulina. E poi aveva necessità di trasfusioni croniche di queste sostanze, di proteine, di albumina. Questo è del dicembre 99, quindi 5 anni dopo il trapianto, in cui in copertina c'è una foto di Nicolas e la foto di Andrea 5 anni dopo il trapianto. All'interno si può vedere la foto di Andrea subito dopo il trapianto, che rende l'idea di che storia è stata, eccolo lì, con tutte le sue ferite, con un torace che sembra un campo di guerra. E oggi è una persona normale che lavora in un call center.
The astonishing thing to me was that immediately donations went up, just within a few days of Nicolas being killed. Not people signing cards, but actual donations. In the first three quarters of 1994, donation rates were flat, almost the lowest in Europe. In the fourth quarter, Nicolas died on the beginning of October. In the fourth quarter, they went up 25% and went on rising for 10 years until they had tripled.
Soprattutto il periodo subito dopo appunto l'evento di Nicolas, sicuramente la nazione è migliorata molto, si è sviluppata, è cresciuta. L'Italia in questo momento è al secondo, terzo posto in Europa come numero di donatori. Per i bambini più piccoli continua a essere un pochino più problematica e più difficile da raggiungere. E il numero di donatori, per quanto si possa fare, non riesce mai a coprire tutte le necessità. È purtroppo tutta una terapia che ha a che fare con una coperta corta, nel senso che gli organi non bastano per tutti i potenziali riceventi, per tutti quelli che ne hanno bisogno. Noi nella nostra lista, oggi abbiamo 35 pazienti, oggi in lista d'attesa del trapianto di cuore, è una mortalità in lista di attesa, quindi senza accedere al trapianto, intorno al 20%. Oggi sono piuttosto buone, sono molto cresciute negli ultimi anni. Oggi diamo una sopravvivenza dell'88-90% a 5 anni e i bambini che sopravvivono a 5 anni hanno ottime probabilità di sopravvivere 10-15-20. I primi due sono viventi dopo 30 anni di trapianto. Questa qui è una ragazza che è stata seguita da noi dalla nascita perché ha una cardiopatia congenita, fino a fare il trapianto nel 2007-2008. E poi si è sposata e ha avuto un figlio dopo il trapianto che compie 2 anni a luglio prossimo. Abbiamo 3 ragazze che hanno avuto figli dopo il trapianto. Questo è un messaggio importante perché ci dice che forse non si può garantire, però è possibile riconquistare una vita normale con il trapianto. Considerarlo forse il più importante atto di solidarietà umana. È qualcosa che unisce tutti. Tutti quanti noi possiamo essere potenziali riceventi e potenziali donatori.
Yes, in the last 21 years I don't think a day has gone by that I tried to do something for donation, even if it's answering emails. But I write articles, I give speeches, I talk to people, and so on. There are many reasons why people don't donate. Some people have religious objections. Some people are afraid that the doctors may not take such good care of them if they donate. To me, one of the most important is that you have no preparation for it. Brain death is sudden death, and people get to the hospital, find someone they love who's dead or dying, and there and then have to make a decision about donating the organs. lowest time of their lives, and to have this decision to make on top of all the other decisions that they have to make is too much for many people, and they say no. And then they regret it for the rest of their lives because they can see that they gave up the opportunity to change the world more than probably at any other time.